Last year, the US was able to smuggle a Russian Pantsir S-1 air defense system out of Libya. The Pantsir is an incredibly popular system used by Russia and a dozen other countries. This makes it an extremely valuable intelligence victory in capturing it and being able to bring it back to the US for evaluation. But this isn't the first time the US got their hands on advanced Russian weaponry. In fact, it's pretty common. But first, this video is sponsored by Blinkist. I have a ton of old books here that I wish I had the time to read. There is so much good information out there that I always feel like I'm missing out on. Well, that's where Blinkist can help. Instead of spending time to read a full book, they offer 15-minute audio highlights of those books, so you can save time, money, and learn new things faster than ever. It's also real useful to go back to old books you had read just to refresh your memory on key points. I had recently spent a lot of time myself going through a book I had read to try to find and remember a key idea. Blinkist would have saved me a lot of time. They have 27 different categories of nonfiction books, along with podcasts as well, so you're bound to find something up your alley. So go check it out right now. The first 100 people to use my link will get unlimited access for 1 week to try it out. Then you'll also get 25% off if you decide to get the full membership. And if you don't like it, just remember to cancel it anytime during that trial and it costs you nothing at all. So go give it a try and see what they have to offer. Again, Blinkist. On paper, the Pantsir is an incredibly advanced and capable system. In real-world operational use, possibly not so much. I made a video just on this system if you're interested, I'll have it linked up in the top right. But either way, its widespread use means that the US acquiring one is major, allowing them to take their time and discover its secrets. There are many reasons why capturing another nation's military systems is extremely valuable. First, you can copy it. The amount of information you can learn from it saves valuable time and money from having to have to develop your own from scratch. The Soviet Union reverse engineering American B-29 bombers at the end of World War II, creating an exact copy that they called the Tu-4, for example. Billions of dollars are spent researching and designing the most advanced and high-tech equipment. And sometimes, that money just ends up being wasted and the program gets canceled after failing to achieve its goals. So stealing from another country that already made the investment can be valuable. Another is to find out how it works so you can find a weakness that can be exploited, and to build defenses against it. You might find that a radar is unable to track certain objects moving at certain speeds, or maybe has a blind spot. One good example was when the USS Halibut recovered hundreds of thousands of fragments from the seafloor of a Soviet P-500 anti-ship missile. They brought these back, reassembled them, and discovered it was only radar-guided, and not infrared as they originally thought. This was extremely valuable as now they could focus defenses against its particular guidance system. Also, you can learn a lot about the country's manufacturing capabilities. The way it was built, assembled, what materials were used, etc. can tell you a lot about them, and offer intelligence on what else they may or may not have the capability to build. And finally, just to learn why they made the decisions they did to make it a certain way. When developing new technology, you will undoubtedly run into problems that need to be solved. So simply making a copy of another nation's military hardware is one thing, but gaining the understanding of why certain design choices were made gives you a whole lot more knowledge, which can then be exploited for your own use. And that Pantsir isn't the first full piece of foreign military gear the US has gotten their hands on. In fact, through various and often secret means, they've gotten many other Soviet and Russian air defense systems, including older S-75, 125, 200, various short-range systems like OSA, and even a few of the long-range S-300. We know they were able to purchase an S-300V directly from Russia, an S-300P from Belarus, and likely one more S-300 PMU-1 through an undisclosed method. Many systems became available to the US with the collapse of the Soviet Union. Countries like East Germany no longer existed and reunified with the US-friendly West Germany. Other former Soviet states and Warsaw Pact countries also became more accessible to the US, opening up opportunities to get their hands on military hardware. The US worked hard to get their hands on Soviet aircraft during the Cold War, and succeeded several times. Several pilots defected, bringing their aircraft with them, either to the US or friendly countries like Japan, West Germany, Turkey, Israel, etc., giving the US the ability to inspect the aircraft and sometimes take them back to the US. Other times, they're able to acquire them covertly, such as this Hind attack helicopter. The CIA noticed a chance to grab it at the end of the Chadanian-Libyan conflict, and secretly flew two Chinooks several hundred miles to pick it up in the middle of the night. Sandstorms delayed the operation, but they eventually succeeded in capturing the helicopter without Libya's knowledge. A lot of this stuff ends up at a place called the Nevada Test and Training Range, which includes Tonopah and the better-known Area 51. Tonopah is fascinating, and often overlooked, getting much less attention than the more famous Area 51. But we have seen some pretty interesting stuff there, like Soviet Scud missiles, another Pantsir that was supposedly on loan from the UAE, and more. The base was also the official home of the 4477th Test and Evaluation Squadron, which flew Soviet fighter jets that they got their hands on. They would test the capabilities of them, and also mock dogfight against US fighter jets so that they could learn how to defeat them. The 4477th shut down with the ending of the Cold War, but Foreign Material Exploitation, or FME, with aircraft continues on today with the more advanced MiG-29s, Su-27s, and others under the name Detachment 3, 53rd Test and Evaluation Group. Another fascinating area in the Nevada Test and Training Range is called the Telecha Peak Electronic Combat Range. Here they test and train against foreign surface-to-air missile systems the US acquired, like the S-125, S-200, and even an S-300. You can see individual radars and a launcher visible in satellite imagery of the area. And the US isn't the only one trying to get their hands on others' military gear. Russia stated that they recovered a relatively intact Tomahawk cruise missile that failed during a strike in Syria. And in the past, they've almost certainly recovered older Tomahawks that were used during Operation Desert Storm. These older missiles didn't have as capable navigation systems as they do today. They relied heavily on images stored in its memory, which would be compared with the terrain it was currently flying over to make sure it was on course. The problem was that Iraq is mostly a flat desert, with very few features in its terrain to figure out where it was. Because of this, they'd sometimes go off course and fail. Sometimes they even had to fly them over the more mountainous regions of western Iran so they can better navigate, and some of those failed. Failed Tomahawk cruise missiles were found in Saudi Arabia, Turkey, and Iran. It's believed Iran recovered at least one of them, possibly using it to help design their Samar cruise missile. China also likely retrieved one, helping design their CJ-10, and Russia likely as well. Regardless of whether it came from the Syria strike or older strikes in Iraq, Serbia, and others, Russia stated that they would use it to help improve their own missiles. Iran also has a long history of capturing US drones, and then creating exact copies and showing them off. Other events, such as the stealth Black Hawk helicopter that crashed during the Bin Laden raid, and the F-117 that was shot down over Yugoslavia, enabled countries to gain intelligence on US stealth technology, likely using it to assist in creating their own. There are also stories on how the Soviet Union was able to obtain US and NATO aircraft, such as an F-86 Sabre during the Korean War. Also, during the Taiwan Strait crisis, an early US Sidewinder missile failed to explode, hit, and got stuck in a MiG-17. The Soviet Union was eventually able to get a hold of it and reverse engineered it, creating the K-13, giving them a great leap in development of infrared air-to-air missiles. And there are likely many more events that we don't know about. For obvious reasons, a lot of this stuff has been kept secret. And for this reason, countries are often very careful who they sell their military equipment to, as they have to consider the risk of it falling into the wrong hands. There was a lot of talk about the possibility of the US selling or loaning F-35s to Taiwan, but there were a lot of concerns of China possibly being able to get their hands on it covertly. The value of getting your adversary's latest and most advanced hardware is extremely high, and this latest story of the Pantsir is just the most recent in a long history of nations attempting to do just that.